Hi there, this is about refrigeration and heat pump, which involves second law of thermodynamics. We define second law in an indirect way, that it is impossible to convert all heat received from a source, a hot source, into work without transferring a part of it to the cold sink. That has been already discussed in Carnot cycle, Carnot engine, heat engines. This is thus the opposite. That means it is possible to withdraw or receive or draw heat from a cold source, a cold body, a cold reservoir or source, and reject a part of it, reject some heat to the hot source, hot reservoir, that is called the hot sink, by performance of external work. There in Carnot heat engine, heat was spontaneously absorbed from, spontaneous word is not befitting, it is absorbed, of course, reversibly, it's a reversible ideal engine, without the application of any external work. Rather, a part of the heat was used to perform expansion work by which the engine operates. But here is the opposite thing. Work has to be done onto the system so that the cycle, it is also the similar cycle as Carnot cycle, but it is called reverse Carnot cycle. You were going in Carnot cycle, we are going in a clockwise manner, like this. But here, we will go in anti-clockwise manner. At a lower temperature, we will expand. And then adiabatic compression. Then in the Carnot engine, Carnot cycle, we are going clockwise. We are coming from, supposing this is A to B, then B to C. Now we will go in the opposite direction. Supposing from here to here, this is isothermal expansion at a lower temperature. And then compression, adiabatic compression to reduce, to increase the temperature. And then isothermal compression, temperature remaining constant. And then there is adiabatic expansion. So just the opposite, so that we can get our opposite effect. That means either cooling effect or heating effect. Supposing you have in a cold country, they use heat pump to generate hot conditions in the room. But in hot countries like ours, we use air conditioners. The principle is same. The principle is same. That is a reverse Carnot cycle. Now let's discuss that. Now, thermodynamics of refrigeration or air conditioner as well as heat pump. Air conditioner and AC, what we call AC, and fridge, refrigerator, they are for cooling purpose and heat pump is for heating purpose. But it is identical. I will explain you how it is identical. Where work is done externally in order to pump out heat from a cold body and reject something to the hot body. During the process, we get the benefit. During this operation, we get the benefit. Now, in one case, in case of air conditioner or fridge, particularly air conditioner, our room is the cold source from which the device removes heat energy, and therefore our room gets cool. And in heat pump, and that is the same in refrigerator. So inside of the refrigerator is the cold source. And in case of heat pump, where there is a heating effect heating the room, there the room is used as the hot sink where heat is thrown into the room. So the room gets heated up because it is already in a lower temperature. Definitely the cold source has to be lower than that. It has to be devised lower than that, so that the room through to which the heat has to be thrown to make it hot, that temperature was already low. So if that is the hot sink, then our cold source has to be still lower than that. Now let's start. This is opposite to heat engine. It is non-spontaneous process. It is called either heat pump for heating purpose or refrigerator or air conditioner for cooling purpose. And both this cycle is called the reverse Carnot cycle. Same. Heat pump is for room heating, while refrigeration is for refrigerators or air conditioners for cooling purpose. When W amount of work is done, then QC amount of heat is drawn from the cold source. Definitely, spontaneously, it will not, heat cannot, heat cannot transfer from a cold body to a hot body. But this is happening due to application of external work. So, QC amount of heat is drawn from the cold source at TC, and it transfers QH amount of heat to the hot sink at TH. TH is always higher than TC. Then let's see what happens. Now this is the general schematic diagram. In the middle it is written heat pump, so don't be swayed away. It is only for heating purpose. This is pumping heat. That is why it is written heat pump, but not in real literary. Scientifically, this is not correct, because usually we use the term heat pump for room heating. So what happens? W amount of work is done onto the system, and then QC amount of heat is drawn from the cold body, that is the cold source. From heat is drawn. And ultimately QH amount of heat is rejected to the hot reservoir or hot sink. Wherever the heat is dumped, it is called sink. From wherever it is taken, it is called source. So here it is cold source, hot sink. In Carnot engine, it was the opposite. Cold sink, it was hot source and cold sink. It was going in this direction. But now it will go in this direction, opposite direction, heat. Now, if the cold reservoir will be the room, then heat will be withdrawn from the room and the room gets cool. And if the room is the hot reservoir, then heat is thrown to the room and the room gets heated. So, only difference is that is this. In case of room heating, we keep the hot reservoir portion, I will explain to you, facing the room. And if it is air conditioning, we keep the cold reservoir or cold source facing the room. But the principle is same. Hot sink. If hot sink is the room, if the hot sink is the room, then it is hot, it is called heat pump. That is for room heating. If cold source or cold reservoir is the room, then it is, or refrigerator inside of the refrigerator, then it is either air conditioner or refrigerator for cooling purpose. And the cycle is called refrigeration cycle. And this is called heat pump cycle. But the two are same, identical. Not different at all. reverse Carnot cycle. Carnot cycle was going clockwise. We will go now anti-clockwise, counterclockwise. Now see, this is the reverse Carnot cycle. Let me explain the four parts, two adiabats and two isotherms. We start from step one. In a very simple and uncomplicated manner, I will explain, but the technology, which is a part of engineering, I'm not a competent person to explain in a greater details. But the principle, as a chemist, as a teacher of thermodynamics, I can explain to you convincingly. Now, what happens here in the step one? This is the isothermal expansion. So there is an evaporator which evaporates the gas. That gas is called the refrigerant. That is originally a liquid, but it is already, I'll explain to you, it has come in the form of gas. So that refrigerant substance can be either, in earlier days, chlorofluorocarbons, hydrochlorofluorocarbons, HCFCs were used. But since it caused a lot of depletion in the ozone hole, ozone layer, created ozone hole, therefore it has been replaced by HFC, fluorocarbons only, hydrofluorocarbons, which have much low power of, you know, making holes in the ozone layer. So in earlier, much earlier days, ammonia was used as a refrigerant liquid. Now that refrigerant now is in the vapor form. It will be evaporating, absorbing at constant temperature. That is connected to the room. Supposing you are interested in air conditioning or cooling, so it is connected to the room. So it will receive the Q amount of, this is QC, as I mentioned in my slide, it is QC, but this is a copy pasted diagram from the Google. So hats off the Google. So I have in my PPT, I have written QC, amount of heat is withdrawn from the room. Room is the cold source from where heat is withdrawn. Then after evaporation, after this step, isothermal expansion step, then it goes to a compression where adiabatic, you know, compression will happen in here. Volume was greater, now volume is lesser. So this will be adiabatic compression. Compression will happen in a compressor where heat will be generated because it is adiabatic. Compression generates higher temperature, heat and higher temperature. So when it will come out of the compressor, it will be superheated vapor. Now here, A means adiabatic. Here, W amount of work. I didn't write net. I simply wrote W. W amount of work is done onto the system, to the compressor, to compress. And so the net work invested onto the system is W. Say upon 1500 joule. And here, it has received 3000 joule from the cold source. Now after being compressed, the adiabatic compression cycle is over, then we go to the isothermal compression. Here there is a condenser. When it goes, the superheated vapor, superheat is removed in a condenser, and the condenser is at a lower temperature, you know, although this is higher than the cold source, but lower than the compressor. I mean, compressor heating, it is highly heated, superheated. So it goes on throwing QH amount of heat. I wrote QH amount of heat to the condenser. I mean, to the surrounding. If the surrounding is room, then room will be benefited if it is a cold room. I mean, hotter than the cold source, but it is a cold room. Then that heat will serve the purpose of room heating, and in that case we designate as a heat pump. In fact, it is heat pump, but often we call heat pump when this hot sink is a part of the room, it is connected to the room. If not, it is another, you know, dissipation of heat has to happen to a particular reservoir where heat will be thrown out at a particular temperature of the hot sink. So QH amount of heat is rejected and the vapor is now condensed. By rejecting heat, it is condensed to liquid. So it will come out as a liquid. Therefore, I said liquid refrigerant, HFCs, chloro is now banned, hydrofluorocarbon. So it will come as a liquid, then it will be subjected to expansion. There is a valve, a very small orifice. This liquid at a high pressure will be allowed to expand to a very low pressure through a orifice, through a nozzle, through a valve, so that this will be a expansion, adiabatic expansion. So this step is adiabatic expansion, where it will come, expansion will reduce the heat and therefore the temperature. So it will come, the temperature will come down to the cold source, a cold source, that is the evaporator. So it will be coming down. So this operation is done to reduce the temperature back to the step one. So this is the two processes. This is isothermal, expansion. This one. Drawing, say for example, 3000 joules, which is QC, and it is going into the compressor, that is adiabatic compression, this step two, where it is compressed and heated and high temperature is achieved, superheated vapor. By that, that happens only by, you know, investment of say Q amount of heat from external source, that say for example 1500 joules is invested as work. And then the superheated vapor is now entered into a condenser, where it throws some heat energy to hot sink. If that hot sink is the room, then room gets the benefit. If it is not, then the sink will take away the heat. Then after being a liquid, total condensation liquid, then it is again subjected to this step, that is adiabatic expansion, where it is again converted to vapor. So when the liquid is converted to vapor here in step 4, this is step 4, and again it enters into the evaporator. So this is the principle of the heat pump or the air conditioner or the fridge refrigerator. If we take the benefit of this, either it is a fridge, inside of the fridge or room, then we call it air conditioner or refrigeration cycle. The same cycle will be called a heat pump cycle when this is the room, where this is the cold source, where temperature will be maintained by a constant temperature infinite source. It will be maintained constant temperature, and here this will be projected to the room. It will be facing the room, so that it will be rejected to the room. Understood? But here you make sure that the first law is not violated. So since it is a the cyclic process, delta E is equal to zero and W is equal to minus Q, or Q is equal to minus Q is equal to minus W. So W is equal to the sum of these two. So here it is heat absorbed, this is positive, and it is rejected, it is emitted. So QH is minus and QC is plus, and there is a minus sign, W is equal to minus Q. So if you multiply by minus, you get minus QC. Yes, W is equal to minus QC plus W, the sum of the two. But QC itself is minus. When we give the sign of the QH, the sign is minus. So QC is plus and QH is minus. So here I have done a mistake. Though this Q is equal to minus Q, so minus total Q. The total work is equal to total. Only one work, but two heats. So minus the total. This QC plus QW. So that is equal to minus QC is positive and this QH is negative. So ultimately it becomes QH minus QC. Right? So now see here exactly this is a tentative, a fictitious data has been given only for just showing you that this QH is 4500 and QC is 3000 and the difference is, 1500. So a less amount of work is invested, but that brings about magical changes. It draws 3000 joules, that is plus, and it rejects 4500 joules to the hot sink, so that QH minus QC will be same as W, right? So more amount of heat is rejected, remember, more amount of heat is rejected to the hot sink than the heat drawn from the cold source, and the work done is less. So let's proceed. We have already discussed everything. Just me read out isothermal the steps. Isothermal heat transfer. The first step is isothermal heat transfer, that is expansion. This is step one, from cold medium, that is cold source or room. If it is room, it is air conditioning. If it is not room and any cold source, then it can be a hot heat pump. So two, a refrigerant, a hydrofluorocarbons, and it evaporates. That is the evaporator which evaporates, expands from a lower volume to higher volume at TC. A lower volume to higher volume from A to B at the same temperature, it is isothermal. Then it is adiabatic compression. It is going to the compression. Adiabatic compression, making superheated vapor, raising the temperature TH. At this point, I forgot to write, W amount of work done onto the system. So at this point, at this step, W amount of work is done onto the system so that compression happens, right? So then step three, it is isothermal compression from C to D. Isothermal heat rejection or compression, that happens in a condenser, converting the superheated, this is the superheated vapor, is condensed to a liquid completely at the same temperature, this isothermal compression. And then finally, when it comes here, this is expansion, adiabatic expansion from D to A, adiabatic expansion, cool down to the same substance to the TC, so that the cycle will be repeated. That is done by a flash evaporation, and that there is a nozzle, high pressure, it is expanded to a low pressure, so there is a cooling, evaporation causes cooling, so the temperature drops down. It is an adiabatic process. Now, just like we had a term called the efficiency of Carnot engine, what was the formula we gave for that? It is efficiency is eta, was the net work extracted from the Carnot engine divided by the heat absorbed from the hot source. But it is different, it is opposite here, and here we have a similar term called coefficient of performance, not efficiency. Coefficient of performance, we shortly write COP, COP, for refrigeration or cooling effect. Always COP is greater than 1. And that the definition is, for refrigeration or cooling, QC by W, the amount of heat absorbed or drawn from the cold source by the work invested. So QC in place of W, we already have calculated using first law, QH minus QC. Because more amount of heat is rejected to the hot sink than it is here. So it is drawn from the cold source. So QH minus QC, in place of W, we write QH minus QC. So QC by QH minus QC. And since these are all isoentropic process, entropy doesn't change. Net entropy is zero. Net entropy change is zero. As much of entropy is gained from the hot from the cold source, same amount of entropy is lost from in the hot sink. So the Q1 by Q2 is equal to T1 by T2. So as we did, so Q1 by T1 is equal to Q2 by Q2. So Q and T, they are proportional. So you write in place of QC by QH minus QC, we write its proportional temperature TC by TH minus TC. So once we know the temperature of the cold source and the hot sink, then we can find out COP. And greater the COP, greater is the cooling effect. And for heat pump, to find out what is the performance of heating the room, then instead of taking QC, we write QH. More the heat rejected to the room or thrown to the room, better is the performance. So instead of QC, we write QH. And therefore, COP for heat pump is greater than, because QH is invariably more than QC for the same amount of work done. So QH, so that becomes QH. Again, in place of W, we write QH minus QC. So here, this is TH by TH minus TC. This was TC by TH by TC. So this is TH by TH minus TC. So only difference is, here we are interested how much of heating effect it will produce from a given amount of work. And here we will produce how much of cooling effect it will produce by how much it is drawing from the room. So that room will be accordingly cool. So that's the difference, otherwise same. And I have already told you, this is isoentropic. And there is another kind of cooling which is the principle of Linde refrigeration. Linde refrigeration, which is not used as a household AC or household refrigerator, but this cooling effect is used for liquefaction of gases. So let us also discuss. This is first law. So no entropy is coming here. This is not isoentropic. This is isoenthalpic. So no second law is coming there. You know, the actual AC and refrigerator or room heater, those we have discussed, they are based on second law. Unless work is performed, you cannot draw heat from the cold body to hot body. And we have done, we have invested work so that we have created, we have succeeded to draw heat from the cold body, reject heat, not part of it, some heat, maybe larger heat to the hot sink, and by that we get the benefit. Either the room is becomes colder, or the other side, the room becomes hotter, right? But here, the temperature variation happens, cooling happens because of adiabatic only one step. Of course, there is a cycle. You continue the same process. There is a cycle, but that is not the same cycle as we have a reverse Carnot cycle or a Carnot cycle. You know, this is a step, but the same gas is again compressed and come back to the same original compressor zone. So the details we are not going to discuss, but here this is a simple scheme for getting a throttle expansion. This is called a throttle expansion. This is a porous plug having very, very fine pores where the gas will be expanded under very, very restricted condition, duress. Now this gas is at a very high pressure. It will be compressed first to develop very high pressure, and the other side will be evacuated. So it will be either very low pressure or vacuum. A vacuum is a misnomer, very low pressure. These are the adiabatic walls. These are all adiabatic, all insulated. So the thermometers are inserted to see what is the temperature drop. Now when you, before you expand, you do not allow this throttle to, this is called throttle. The porous plug is called a throttle. This is called a throttle or porous plug. This is not allowed to open. First develop pressure, compress it, and then develop low pressure, evacuate, and then open the throttle so that it will expand adiabatically from a high pressure to low pressure. Thereby, it will exhaust all its internal energy. As you know, adiabatic delta E is equal to W. So there will be a huge decrease in internal energy, and when this side it will come, it will be cooled. That happens with majority of the gases. excepting a couple of gases and a few gases like hydrogen and helium, which have a very, very high inversion temperature. I'll tell you what is inversion temperature. If you have already studied gaseous state, you must have studied Joule-Thomson effect. This is called Joule-Thomson effect, which works on first law. Delta E is equal to W because Q is equal to zero. Now here, the enthalpy during the expansion remains the same. What is the enthalpy? You know, the enthalpy change is zero. The enthalpy of the initial state is equal to enthalpy of the final state. The initial state was at pressure P1, high pressure, volume V1, and temperature was higher. And final pressure is very low. It was very low. And then volume is V2, and temperature is obviously low. These are the conditions. So we will prove that this is isoenthalpic. That was isoentropic. Some people call isentropic, isenthalpic. They don't put O. But I really sigh away without putting O. Isoenthalpic. That was isoentropic. Entropy is the main feature there. But here enthalpy is the main feature. So first law. Now let's prove why the enthalpy before in the initial state and final states are same. Initial state and final states are same. Now the work done during compression will be equal to minus P delta V. Since the final volume is zero, it will be compressed totally to this place. So there will be total reduction of volume to zero volume. So the final volume is 0, V2 minus V1. V1 is the initial volume. So minus P1, 0 minus V1. That is P1, V1. Plus, minus, minus, plus. And this will expand. You know, it was having 0 volume because this piston was originally here. There was no gas. It was here. Now, some gas will come here. And after expansion, it will do expansion work. Here, this is the compression work. This is expansion work. From 0 volume to V2 volume. So initial is 0, so V2 minus V1, so V2 minus initial is 0, and minus sign is there, so it becomes minus P2 V2. So this was plus P1 V1, this is minus P2 V2. So total work done during these two processes, this is compression, this is expansion, is W1 plus W2 is equal to P1 V1 minus P2 V2. And we know delta E is equal to W for adiabatic case. So delta E is nothing but E2 minus E1. Is equal to W, total work done is P1 V1 minus P2 V2. So when you equate this and bring and group it, regroup it, you will find E1 plus P1 V1 is equal to E2 plus P2 V2. So what is E1 plus P1 V1? It is nothing but enthalpy in the initial state. And what is E2 plus P2 V2? It is enthalpy in the final state. So H1 minus H2, that is delta H, is equal to 0. So during this throttled expansion, adiabatic throttled expansion, there is no change in enthalpy. So that is isoenthalpic, right? Now, I will talk about inversion temperature. Inversion temperature is that temperature below which, if the throttle expansion will happen, it will bring about, cooling effect. There will be more attraction between the molecules, so it will lose energy, internal energy will be decreased, and there will be cooling effect. But if the working temperature is above the inversion temperature of the gas, so there is a repulsion effect. There is a repulsion effect for which there will be increase in internal energy. That is an interesting aspect. There will be increase in internal energy due to repulsion effect. And the temperature will increase. There is a heating effect. So, those are the two very few cases, hydrogen and helium, they have a sub-zero inversion temperature. So, when we are working above sub-zero, that means at room temperature, then instead of having a cooling effect, we will be getting a heating effect because of repulsion factor. Those gases are extremely small, and even if they have come to low pressure, their repulsion effect will not go because their critical temperature is low, their inversion temperature is low, sub-zero. So everything is sub-zero. Their Boyle's temperature is low, so you have at this thing. So I have something in mind to tell you about this. Just hold on. And there is a coefficient called Joule-Thomson coefficient. To know whether there is a cooling effect or heating effect from the value, I would like to share some of my gaseous state. Now, in the gaseous state, I told you there is a heating effect. I have written here Y heating effect. At high temperature than Ti, when we are working above Ti, the like helium and hydrogen, the predominant force is intermolecular repulsion. When gas is expanded, the molecules go farther apart. Hence, there will be decrease in repulsion, no doubt, and hence heat is evolved. When there is more decrease in repulsion, there was more repulsion, there is less repulsion, so heat is evolved. In other words, in this case, there is an increase in internal energy, E. Due to this effect, there is a heating effect. But below Ti, inversion temperature, most of the gases are higher Ti, far above the room temperature. So when we are working under room temperature condition, why there is a cooling effect for most of the gases? At lower temperature, the predominant force is intermolecular attraction, and there is a, when the gas expands, the intermolecular distance increases and hence attraction decreases, and energy has to be absorbed from the system. So when there was high attraction and you are decreasing the attraction, so some energy has to be invested from the surrounding so that the surrounding gets cool. In other words, the work done by the gas brings about decrease in internal energy. But here there was profuse repulsion, and when the expansion will happen, there is a reduction in repulsion. There it was reduction in attraction. Here it is reduction in repulsion. For that, heat will be evolved so that it will make heating effect. So that's why I was just missing out to explain it correctly. I noted it in my lecture notes. So I discussed, and this is what is mu, the coefficient of Joule-Thomson effect. That is called Joule-Thomson coefficient, mu. That is nothing but equal to del T by del P at constant enthalpy, the change of temperature with respect to change of pressure. How much of temperature change occurs with change in pressure? What is the temperature drop or temperature change with respect to pressure drop? So if it is a cooling effect, both are decreasing, pressure from high to low, temperature from high to low. So the difference, this difference by this difference, they will have the same sign, and therefore it is positive. So when you find a mu value given positive, then certainly that that gas or that particular system will bring about cooling effect, right? And if you find mu is negative, when delta P is from higher to lower, but temperature is from lower to higher, then the difference by this difference will be negative. And once you get mu is equal to negative, we have a heating effect. So that happens with only few gases, a couple of gases, hydrogen, helium, and maybe to some extent neon. And I don't remember the Ti value of neon, but these two have sub-zero Ti value, and others have above room temperature, so they produce cooling effect. Now what I was saying is, when by chance mu is zero, for some system mu is equal to zero, then there will be no effect, neither heating nor cooling. And we have not derived here, that is in the gaseous state, domain of gaseous state, the inversion temperature is related to van der Waals constant, like this 2A by RB. Just I am reminding you that this Ti is 2 times greater than the Boyle's temperature, which is A by RB. This is 2A by RB. Now, this is used, as I have told you, Linde refrigeration cycles. This is called Linde refrigerator, and that is used for liquefaction of gases. For example, you are liquefying air to separate liquid nitrogen and oxygen and separate them. So what do? You cool down to certain extent by using cooler, then you subject it to high pressure, keeping the throttle, you know, without opening, it will remain closed, and develop high pressure on the gas, nitrogen, oxygen or air, and then develop low pressure on the other side, then suddenly expand adiabatically, insulated condition. Then this side will be, it will be cool. Supposing in one go, it has come down from say 0 degree to 0 degree, up to 0 degree you can cool by ice and all that, or even less than that by dry ice. Supposing from 0 to it has come down to minus 20, then take that minus 20 cooled gas and again cycle back to the compressor so that it will be compressed again and evacuate on the other side. Again make a throttle expansion. So again minus 20 will be converted to minus 30. So you repeated throttle expansion, you will be cycle. This cycle is called a Linde cycle. It's not similar to Carnot cycle or reverse Carnot cycle that works on entropy. There is no change in entropy in a reverse. I mean, whether reverse or forward, it is isoentropic. So that is a reversible condition. Don't confuse with reverse and reversible. So whatever the case may be, here the Linde cycle, you know, same cooled gas is recycled back to the compressor to further cool. Another Joule-Thomson effect. Then again minus 30, again you compress minus 40. In this way, repeatedly you carry out Zeti effect, the Joule-Thomson effect, supposing that temperature now comes down below its critical temperature. For example, the critical temperature of say nitrogen is minus, say, I don't remember, minus 115, for example. The boiling point is much low, minus 115, supposing. So you at least you have to cool with repeated Joule-Thomson effect up to minus 115, then you need not. You simply compress at a high pressure, it will be liquefied. So you know from the gaseous state chapter, a gas can be liquefied by applying pressure alone if the working temperature is below its critical temperature. So you have to cool down at least up to the critical temperature or little below the critical temperature of the gas by Zeti effect, Joule-Thomson effect. This is not the effect which we use for household refrigeration or household heating. That works on second law. This works on first law. I think this is almost going to the end of our thermodynamics lectures, and we will enter into numerical session in the next lecture. Thank you. Bye-bye.